Hey, it's Professor Dave. Let's learn about how cells communicate with one another.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
We've learned about a lot of the complex biochemistry that occurs inside every single one of your cells. But it actually gets even more complicated than that, because your cells need to communicate with one another in order to respond to environmental stimuli, like potential danger, and to elicit certain behavior during various stages in your lifetime, so that your body makes the correct changes as you grow. How does this communication take place? Well, we learned about receptors that sit in the cell membrane and wait for a particular substrate to bind. Many of these receptor substrates are signaling molecules like hormones and neurotransmitters, which, upon binding to the receptor, set off the process of signal transduction, which can have a variety of results. Some of this signaling is local, occurring between adjacent cells. But long-distance signaling can also occur, where a message travels all the way across your body to deliver a signal to a particular type of cell. In examining these signaling pathways, we want to talk about three types of signaling. Those are autocrine, paracrine, and endocrine. The prefix auto means self, so autocrine signaling refers to when a cell secretes signaling molecules, which then bind to receptors on that same cell. This will trigger some kind of response from the cell. The prefix para means beside or nearby, so paracrine signaling is a type of local signaling where a compound, like a growth factor, is secreted by a cell, which then interacts with nearby cells. Growth factors are signals that tell a cell to begin dividing, which is what allows us to become so much taller during intense periods of growth in childhood. Another example of local signaling is called synaptic signaling. This is how messages travel through your nervous system. A nerve cell can be triggered by an electrical signal to release certain molecules called neurotransmitters into the synaptic space, which then interact with the next nerve cell, eliciting another electrical signal, which releases neurotransmitters into the next synaptic space, and so forth. A nerve cell can also be attached to a muscle cell, which makes it able to trigger muscular contraction. This kind of signaling is used when your hand needs to tell your brain that something it is touching is hot, which will then send another signal back down to your hand to tell it to stop touching it. An incredible amount of chemistry has to happen for all those signals to be transmitted. But lucky for us, chemistry happens imperceptibly quickly. And lastly, the long-distance signaling that happens in our bodies occurs via endocrine signaling. This is when a particular type of compound, called a hormone, is released by a gland and is then carried through the bloodstream to its destination. This system has a range of functions, like maintaining blood pressure, the regulation of development, and more. So what are the names of some of these hormones and neurotransmitters? And what exactly are the messages they carry? Many of the signaling molecules fall into three structural categories: polypeptides, like oxytocin, steroids, like cortisol, and amines, like epinephrine. We've already learned about the properties of these types of molecules, so let's talk about how they interact with the body. First, let's discuss their variance in solubility. Polypeptides and amines are water-soluble, whereas steroids are not. But nonpolar molecules, like steroids, are lipid-soluble, so this discrepancy will affect the way these molecules are transmitted. Water-soluble hormones can travel through the aqueous bloodstream freely, but they can't pass through the nonpolar plasma membrane of a cell. So these will typically be recognized by receptors on the surface of the cell, which, upon binding, will initiate signal transduction. For example, when an organism finds itself in a particularly stressful situation, like evading a predator, the adrenal glands secrete a hormone called epinephrine. This is more commonly known as adrenaline. When this molecule reaches liver cells, it binds to a membrane receptor. This sets off a cascade of events which generates cAMP, which in turn activates an enzyme called protein kinase A. This enzyme will inhibit glycogen synthesis and promote glycogen breakdown. This means that the cell will stop storing glucose in the form of glycogen and will instead start breaking up glycogen to make more glucose molecules, which will enter the bloodstream and become available for cellular respiration. Essentially, it kicks energy production into overdrive so that the organism can get away from the predator. By contrast, lipid-soluble hormones will have to bind to transport proteins in order to be soluble in the bloodstream. But once they reach a cell, they are typically able to pass right through the cell membrane, being nonpolar. So the receptors that interact with these types of hormones are usually already inside the cell. For example, in many vertebrates, like birds and frogs, estradiol is a hormone that regulates female reproductive function. This can enter a liver cell and bind to a receptor in the cytoplasm. This complex will then undergo a conformational change due to the binding that allows it to enter the nucleus, bind to a specific DNA sequence, and transcribe the gene for vitellogenin. Once produced, this protein is then transported to the reproductive system to produce egg yolk. Some lipid-soluble hormones pass through both the cell membrane and nuclear membrane to bind to a nuclear receptor. Again, nuclear receptors are typically transcription factors, which, once activated, will initiate the expression of a particular gene. Some hormones elicit multiple responses simultaneously. Let's look at epinephrine again. Not only will this promote glycogen breakdown, but it also increases blood flow to skeletal muscles and decreases blood flow to the digestive tract. How can it do all these things at once? It's partially because different cells might contain different enzymes than others and therefore elicit a different cellular response to the same hormone. But also, some hormones are able to activate several completely different receptors, each with their own unique response to binding. Here we can see two different receptors, called alpha and beta receptors, existing on three different cell types, as well as each unique result, whether increase of blood glucose, blood vessel dilation, or blood vessel constriction. As we said, all hormones are secreted from glands. Here are just some of the glands in your body, including the hypothalamus, thyroid, pineal, and pituitary glands, as well as the hormones they mediate. Many of these may sound familiar, and they have a wide variety of functionality, including the regulation of biological rhythms, like your sleep cycle, as well as growth, metabolic functions, and social behavior. There are far too many to go through them individually, but it is more important that we understand the general mechanisms by which they operate so that we can apply this understanding to any individual example. And most importantly, we must understand how the endocrine system and the nervous system work together to play a critical role in organizing all the cellular activity of an organism to contribute towards a common goal, the survival of the organism. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials, and as always, feel free to email me, professordaveexplains@gmail.com.